sir. Okay. Professor K.K. Y. Rera, council member of the Sri Lanka Technological Chambers. Mr. Radhe Prabhupada, President and CEO of the Sri Lanka Technological Chambers. Mr. Rohan Fernando, Group Chairman of SLP. Mr. Oshata Senanayake, Director General of the RC. Mr. Arunabha Vishakun, Secretary of the Ministry of Youth and Sports. Professor Randipi Sanaka, Secretary of the State Ministry of Rural Roads and Infrastructure. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to be here with you on this auspicious occasion, which signifies the opening of your research topic and also your research awards. I think the Sri Lanka Technological Campus is a significant achievement by any standard, and I would like to explain to you briefly why I consider this initiative to be entirely commendable and in keeping with the country's educational priorities. One of the most noteworthy aspects of the planning that went into the formation of this institution, as was explained by Sir Dr. Gopisankar, was a critical examination of the needs of the customer. Your choice of faculties, the disciplines that you are going to teach in this technological campus. You have technology, you have engineering, you have business studies, you have IT, all of this. And another interesting addition, which is quite unusual, is you. Now, the situation with regard to education in our country is this. We are making a determined effort to make higher education accessible to ever-increasing numbers of students. Last year, the total intake into the 15 universities of Sri Lanka was 30,000. We have 15 universities in the country, and last year we admitted 30,000 students. This year we are increasing it to 41,500. That itself is only an increase of 11,500. But recently, for various reasons, we have had to increase that for another 540 students. On top of that, we are planning to establish 10 city universities. 10 city universities, that's a program that is supported by the Asian development attack. Now this is desirable, this will be done, because students who demonstrate their capability to benefit from higher education must have the opportunity of being admitted to Sri Lanka universities. But we need to consider the future of these students after they acquire academic qualifications in these institutions of higher learning. What happens to them? Whatever. Today, it is beyond dispute that there is a righteous mismatch between the education that we impart in our universities and the livelihood opportunities that are available that are important for higher education. So we have to ensure that within the walls of these institutions, we equip students to bear satisfying employment and to live the life of dignity and contentment. I have personally spoken to the chairman and the directors of some of the largest companies in Sri Lanka. They tell me there's no shortage of jobs. They are in the position to offer jobs in their institutions. But when they interview graduates, they find that the graduates do not have the skills, the aptitudes which they are looking for in their institutions. So this is the mismatch. between the content of the education that is provided, the attitudes that are nurtured, and the availability of job opportunities for those who graduate from the institution. So this is the imbalance. That has to be addressed. Nobody is more acutely aware of this than I am. Because in the period 1988-89, we have short memories in our country. Many of us have forgotten the trauma that we all went through during that period. Universities, schools, banks, hospitals, everything was closed. Universities for more than 2 years. And my predecessor in the office of Vice Chancellor of the University of Colombo, the late Professor Stanley Jesuit, who never did any harm to anybody, he was a very gentle man. He was assassinated in his own office. Then it goes into this area, the Professor Kautilan, who was then Vice Chancellor of the University of Maharashtra, was also brutally killed. Now, these were symbolic assassinations. There was no personal one. It was not anger directed against the individual, but it was indignation directed against the social order in Germany. So when you educate a child, when you confer a degree on him, naturally he has high levels of expectation. He expects to get a job that is commensurate with his qualifications. And if he then finds that in spite of his qualifications, he is not able to get any employment at all, let alone suitable employment, the natural reaction of any human being is deep resentment against the social order that is produced. That's it. So that is why the Sri Lanka Technological Campus is an achievement, because you have identified your priorities. What are the disciplines that you are going to teach? 100%, as the Honorable Dr. Murad told me a few minutes ago, 100% employment oriented. The graduates that you produce, in the disciplines that you teach within these walls, there's a virtual guarantee of employment, because these are the skills that are very much in demand as Sri Lanka's economy marches forward. So the relevance of courses, relevance, pragmatism, practicality, those are the elements that have guided your thinking with regard to the choice of courses in this new adventure. So that is something that I would like to mention. The other is your vision. We will just call that. What is important is the vision that has led to the establishment of these institutions. The Latin maxim that you have chosen, non scholari sed vitae distinguo. That means we study not for a school but for life. Not for a school, non scholari, not for a school, sed vitae, not for life. So these are lifelong skills. You are not preparing students simply to sit for examinations and again paper qualifications, but you are imparting to them an education that will stand them in good stead throughout their lives and their careers. I think that is important. Now, one of the things that the Education Ministry proposes to do next month, in the month of March, is to launch a digital platform. Digital platform, we will be inviting teachers, parents, students to give us their ideas about how the educational curriculum should be reformed in this country. Because by any standard it is obsolete, anachronistic. It has not been revisited for 2 decades. We are far behind the times. Not only with regard to the content of subjects, but also with regard to methodology, the teaching methods. Now, what is the purpose of education? You have used the Latin term. The word education itself comes from the Latin word educare. Educare in Latin means to draw out. You are trying to draw out from the child. Not to pack into the child's mind a vast volume of factual material, which a student is required to retain in his memory and then reproduce The whole purpose of education is to develop the critical faculty, analytical abilities, to encourage the student to think for himself and herself, and to equip the student to contend with the challenges of life. So that's what you are planning to do, to develop the critical faculty of the student, to develop a sense of proportion, to take risks. Life is an adventure. Education is a voyage of discovery. We are not confined to work there. So these are the values that you have had in mind when you put together the courses of study that you plan to impart in this technological campus. Then there is one other point I want to make. It's rather interesting that you have included music. That's very important. That's all. The rest of it is all very clearly employment oriented. Engineering, technology, IT, business studies. Also included music. That is good. Those are the finer things in that. Supposing I told you that you have enrolled about 50 students for music. That was a very high demand. More than 10 times that number wanted to be enrolled for studies in music. Honorable Ramakunathana told me that I asked, what are their career options? What are the students in music proposing to do when they complete their studies? Actually, there are avenues for employment that are available not only in this country, but more importantly, at the international level. So the finer things, the minds and the spirit, the refinements, which are very much a part of the complete human being. Complete human being is the end product of a comprehensive educational system. Now, if you ask me, what is the other main problem regarding education in our country? It is the fact that we are imparting education in a spiritual vacuum. Spiritual vacuum. You know, one of the most important things I have done in my life was my involvement in the Presidential Youth Commission, which was appointed by the then government after the turbulent events. The events of 1988-89. The then government wished to understand this phenomenon. What is it that causes this extraordinary situation? And what are the measures that we should put in place to prevent the recurrence of that situation in the foreseeable future? We went all over the country, the late Ralph Wallace, Dr. Radhika Kumar Swami, Professor Lakshman Rathbun, who was the Vice Chancellor of the University of Kerala. We heard sometimes we were talking about the meetings at my house. Now, when we spoke to students all over the country, we asked them, why did you do this? Why was it necessary to assassinate Vice Chancellors, converting ourselves? They said, no. I said, there is one way to be noticed. Otherwise, nobody listens to our voice. It all goes by default. Some of the most important educators in the country, including a leading bishop, known as, one of the main problems with regard to education is that there are no role models. You can't tell your students, what is your life from so and so? There's so much cynicism, skepticism. It is therefore necessary to ensure that education is provided in a cultural and spiritual setting. That's very important. And I think that is something that you are endeavoring to. The scale of values, the sense of proportion which must underpin the education that you provide. So I don't wish to say much more. The emphasis on research is also very good. You know, the university has two main functions. One is teaching, the other is research. Both are important. And it is necessary to strike a perceptive balance between these two things. And listening to Sanatana Guru Singh, I think you have struck that equilibrium
We link these two objectives from a university. So I wish to congratulate you warmly on this achievement. It is something that our country needs at this time. And I assure you that the Ministry of Education will provide you with every support and encouragement as you march into the future. You can count on our blessings and our material support in the achievement of the objectives that you have set yourself. Thank you very much.